Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome. Today we celebrate the Mass for the second Sunday of Lent. Our processional, I will bless the Lord at all times. Please rise.
A reading from the book of Genesis. God put Abraham to the test. He called to him, "Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son, Isaac, your only one whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah. There you shall offer up him up as a holocaust, on a height that I will point out to you." When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. Then he reached out and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the Lord's messenger called called to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Here I am," he answered. "Do not lay your hand on the boy," said the messenger. "Do not do the least thing to him. I know how devoted you are to God, since you did not withhold from me your own beloved son." As Abraham looked about, he spied a ram caught by its horns in the thicket. So he went and took the ram, and he offered it up as a holocaust in place of his son. Again, the Lord's messenger called to Abraham from heaven and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you acted as you did in not withholding from me your beloved son, I will bless you abundantly and make your descendants as countless as the stars of the sky and the sands of the seashore. Your descendants shall take possession of the gates of their enemies, and in your descendants all the nations of the earth shall find blessing. All this because you obey my command." The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Father's voice is heard. This is my beloved Son. Listen to him. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus took Peter, James, and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his clothes became dazzling white, such as no fuller on earth could bleach them. Then Elijah appeared to them along with Moses, and they were conversing with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus in reply, "Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He hardly knew what to say. They were so terrified. Then a cloud came, casting a shadow over them. From the cloud came a voice, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." Suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone but Jesus alone with them. As they were coming down from the mountain, he charged them not to relate what they had seen to anyone, except when the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what rising from the dead meant. The Gospel of the Lord.
I'd like to start by asking you to call to mind your image of God. And most of us can probably come up with one. What is your image of God? In other words, who is God to you? Who is God in your daily life? Who is God when you're doing something good? And who is God when you've committed a sin? I think it's important to reflect on our image of God, because that determines so much how it is we relate to God. It determines how we love God. It even determines if we love God. And that's also an important question to reflect on. Do we truly love God? And I'd like to give you an example of someone who struggled with that. Martin Luther, a 16th century Protestant reformer, you remember he started out as a Catholic monk, and he struggled horribly with scrupulosity. Scrupulosity is that constant fear that one is in a state of mortal sin, a constant fear that one has offended God. So for the scrupulous person, confession provides little relief. They go to confession, and almost immediately after, they begin examining the confession and wondering, did they tell their sins properly? Did they leave something out? Did they forget to say something, and therefore it's a bad confession, and so forth. And so Luther struggled mightily with this. He would spend hours trying to call to mind all of his sins. And then, when he went to confession, he would come out convinced he'd done it wrong, and he would start over. Luther would do constant severe penance, trying to convince God he was sorry for his sins, trying to avoid God's wrath. As you can imagine, Luther's superiors were out of their minds. They didn't know what to do with this monk who was struggling so much. And so they thought it would be a good idea to assign him to study the mystics. Because if he read the writings of the saints who were mystics, he would discover who God is. But as Martin Luther studied the mystics, he came to a horrifying conclusion. All of the mystics throughout the ages have one thing in common. They love God. And to Luther's horror, he discovered he didn't love God. In fact, he hated God. Because how can one love a tyrant? Luther had to find a new image of God, one that was not tyrannical, not was of a God who was constantly trying to trap him in every sin. And so Luther studied scripture, and he found his salvation in in St. Paul's letter to the Romans, where he learned that salvation is a free gift from a generous God who saves us in an act of love. Luther learned that God is love. God desires to save us. God desires to free us from sin rather than condemn us. From that point on, Martin Luther was free to love God. Unfortunately, his movement led him out of the Catholic Church. But what he learned about God is absolutely true. God loves us. God desires to save us. And God is extremely generous with salvation. So what about our image of God? As Catholics, there are certain things that we're required to think about God. And they're found in the Nicene Creed. They're found in the Bible, especially in the New Testament and the teachings of Jesus. We find some of the basics in the Catechism. But apart from that, we are completely free to explore our image of God. And if we find that our image of God is harmful, that most of the time, God is in a bad mood, or God is a traffic cop, in constant track of our sins, then we are free, we are absolutely free to reject that image of God and to find a new one. The one thing we don't reject, of course, is what we know about God in the Creed, in the New Testament, the teachings of Jesus, but we are free to embrace the loving concept of God. And in today's Gospel, we see a wonderful image of God. God speaks from the heavens about Jesus. This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And that is an awesome word, beloved. With that statement, this is my beloved Son, we get an image of God as a truly loving Father, one who is crazy in love for his beloved Son. And from the teachings of Jesus, we learn that we too are beloved sons and daughters of God. But we can only believe that, we can only trust that statement, if we believe that God is a loving Father who is in fact crazy in love for us, each one of us. And if we believe that, then we know that love demands sacrifice. Love demands even being willing to lay down one's life for the beloved. God himself did it, in the person of Jesus on the cross. Countless saints and martyrs throughout the ages have done it as well, because they knew that God loved them passionately, and they loved God in return. For us to really and truly embrace that concept that God is love, we have to clear out any harmful images of God that we may have accumulated over the years. So for example, if their father was unloving or abusive or alcoholic, or if he gave or withheld love and approval based upon the child's behavior, or if he walked out, if he abandoned the family altogether, then the idea of God as Father is going to require some healing. And we don't reject the concept of God as Father, but we have to reject the image of God as a Father who hurts or abandons us. That means we have to open up our hearts to the concept of Father itself being healed within us, and then we're truly free to receive God's love and to love God and each other as we were meant to. We also have to be careful of any image of God that we've constructed to make him in our own image. We probably know what that means. You know, that God likes the people we like. God dislikes the people we like. God votes the way we do. God belongs to our political party. God belongs to whatever. You know, we have to ask the Holy Spirit to help form within us an image of God that is loving, holy, and also healthy. So I'd like to return to that first question. What is your image of God? Is there anything that needs to go in order for the living God to reveal himself? Can we experience a kind of transfiguration similar to what Peter, James, and John experienced? Can we glimpse, even for a moment, God's glory, God's true and unconditional love for us? If we can, then we will be transformed. We will become the people that God has called us to be, a people who are glorified, people who are transfigured, a people so loved, so in love, that we're willing to lay even down our lives for the very sake of love. and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Trusting in God's love for us, we offer our prayers and our petitions to him.
For the church, that we may reveal to all the love God has for each person, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who struggle with their image of God, that they may let go of harmful images in order to experience the love of God as he really is, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who continue to experience the effects of racism and violence, that we may learn to see each other as brothers and sisters, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For those who are sick, who are hospitalized, and those who are facing the end of earthly lives, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all those who have died, that they may see and experience the glory of God for all eternity, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
We take a moment to place in God's hands our own petitions. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Lord God, we ask you to open our eyes. May we see your love for us. Transform us so that we may be truly loving to one another. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. To your goodness we have received the bread we offer. Fruit of the earth, work of human hands, that will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. To your goodness we have received the wine we offer. Fruit of the vine, work of human hands, that will become our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Sacrifice of yours, and acceptable to God the Almighty Father. May this sacrifice, O Lord, we pray, cleanse us of our faults, and sanctify your faithful in body and mind for the celebration of the Paschal festivities, through Christ our Lord. Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For after he had told his disciples of his coming death, how the holy mountain he manifested to them his glory, to show even by the testimony of the law and the prophets that the passion leads to the glory of the resurrection. And so with the powers of heaven we worship you constantly on earth, and before your majesty without end to be our claim.
There we hope to God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Thank you.
Let us pray. As we receive these glorious mysteries, we make thanksgiving to the Lord for allowing us, while still on earth, to be made partakers even now of the things of heaven, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a couple of announcements. First of all, this afternoon at 3 o'clock, there's a webinar, and it's called Black Catholic History, Vision, Voice, and Vigilant. So on our website, there's a link to that. There's also a link to our own parishioner, Bridget Stiegel's wonderful videos on Black Catholic figures. And finally, there's also a link to a three-part documentary that's appeared on public television, and it's called The Black Church. It's wonderful. I've watched some clips of it. I haven't been able to watch the whole thing yet, but it's gotten great reviews. And it's the history of Christianity in the African-American community. So the links to that program are on our website. And then finally, next weekend is the beginning of our Deacon Diaper Drive. And so please bring some diapers and put them in the St. Vincent de Paul box. Have a great week.
Yeah.